Hello, and welcome to this episode of the National Arts Center NACOcast series. My name is Sean Rice, and I am the second clarinetist with the National Arts Center Orchestra. Welcome to our third episode on our series covering Beethoven's symphonies. Maestro Alexander Shelley and I are back in the Hexagon Room at the National Arts Center today to continue this discussion. Thanks for being here again.
Well, thank you.
We've had two really interesting discussions already.
Absolutely.
And now we're going to cover the last three symphonies that Beethoven composed, 7, 8, and 9.
Exactly.
So the 7th symphony. I mean, that movement in the funeral march,
right? Yeah.
Is quite popular. Most people will recognize it almost as much as the 5th symphony.
Exactly. Yeah. It's I think along with the real sort of funeral march in the 3rd symphony and then the 5th symphony, I think it's one of his most beloved movements. Mm-hmm. And in fact, during his, you know, up until that point in his life, the response to the 7th symphony seems to have been the best response he had in any concert.
Well, didn't they encore that one movement?
They did.
Yes,
exactly.
Yeah, at the premiere.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the premiere itself was a very interesting affair. It was, the years, we left off with the 6th symphony in our last conversation. Beethoven's condition, sort of physically, his hearing, also his state had somewhat sort of deteriorated in those few years. People were saying that, you know, his physical condition didn't look good on the streets. He was a bit sort of raggedy, his clothes, and he was definitely losing his hearing to a degree that it never happened before. And also there was a political change occurring in Europe. So Napoleon had started a war on another front. He'd gone east and he'd gone into Russia, and the Russians had retreated and retreated and retreated. Mm-hmm. And Napoleon, as you know, so many conquerors before and since, ended up fighting the winter in Russia more than the Russians. And he had to retreat, and he lost a huge part of his army, and that was the beginning of the end for him. And at Waterloo, there was the battle which ultimately sort of put an end to the heights of his reign against Wellington. And the reason I mention that is that the political landscape had changed. Napoleon was in retreat. Wellington had just had this victory, and Meltzer, the guy who invented the metronome, who was a friend of Beethoven's, he said, "You know what? We should write a piece that celebrates Wellington's victory, and it's called Wellington's Victory, Wellington's Sieg, which is this weird parody of a piece." And it was that piece that was being premiered at the same time as the 7th Symphony in 1813.
Okay.
So the concert itself was also a fundraiser for war veterans, for injured from that war, and as it sort of sounds when you read about it, it sounds like it was just a big kind of fun knees up for everybody involved. It was just a real laugh. And you know, the musicians who were involved in the premiere of Wellington's Victory and of the 7th Symphony are extraordinary. Salieri was playing in the orchestra. Hummel was playing in the orchestra. Spohr, the composer, was playing in the orchestra.
Yeah.
Dragonetti, the bassist, was playing in the orchestra. Giacomo Meyerbeer was playing in the orchestra. And then Ignaz Schuppanzig, who was the leader who led for a lot of Beethoven symphonies, was leading the orchestra. But in Wellington C, you know, Hummel and Salieri, they were playing the big drum. I mean, it must have been absolutely hysterical.
He wrote,
yeah,
he wrote a lot of clarinet.
Exactly, right. Yeah. I saw that's why your ears pricked up.
Like, yeah,
boring Spohr. But no, it's quite an image. All these amazing musicians there taking part in it. And Wellington's Victory is a really weird parody of a piece, as I say. Mm-hmm. And it's loud and crazy, and there's a march, and there's all these other things. And the 7th Symphony followed that. Now Wellington's Victory had been a huge hit. The audience absolutely loved it.
Okay.
And contemporary descriptions of the concert say that the 7th could never really have the impact that Wellington's Victory had in that concert, because people were on such a high.
Yeah.
But they do say that despite that, the reception of the symphony was better than he'd ever had before in anything. And as you said, the second movement, the Allegretto, had to be repeated immediately because people loved it. I mean, and it is such a powerfully beautiful movement. And I think when we're talking about the 7th, there's a very, very famous quote by Wagner. He said it's the apotheosis of dance. And I think that's a very interesting way for us to sort of approach our conversation, because even in that allegretto, the second movement, which traditionally one would think of as the slow movement, it's an allegretto. Pom, 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 pim, pom, 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 pom. Oh, that's the marked tempo from Beethoven. There have been beautiful versions over the years which are considerably slower.
So much slower.
Considerably slower. Yeah. But bearing in mind what he marked as a tempo and the fact that it's an allegretto, it breaks this expectation that it would be a slow movement in inverted commas. Right. You know, everything indicates that it's not. The reason I mentioned that movement in sort of conjunction with the Wagner quote is that if you take it the allegretto at face value, if you take his tempo marking at face value, then what could have been a funeral march turns more into a sort of funeral dance.
There's a real lilt.
Exactly, exactly. Yeah. And if you feel the tempo that he marked, you feel the allegretto, it actually goes into a one, and then you start to feel the four bars and the eight bars. And I think it's a very interesting way of thinking about it. And to just drill into that a little bit, one of the reasons that the Wagner and many other people have described it as the sort of dance incarnate, the symphony, is because the first movement, despite having the longest introduction, actually, of any of his symphonies, a very long and very, very impactful introduction. It's the main body of the first movement is based around a simple figure, which is a dance-like figure. And that's a figure which has a, you know, long history for students in music, because it's a rhythm that is very easy to slightly play wrong.
Of course, so,
yeah. So it's based, for those of you listening, if you imagine 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It's based around the triplet wop pop 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 pop, and it's pop 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 pop. A word that's often used when teaching this is Amsterdam, Amsterdam, Amsterdam.
I've never heard that actually.
It's called the Amsterdam rhythm. Yeah.
Oh, really? Okay.
But one of that motif runs almost continually through the whole first movement. It gives this ebullient sort of sense of joy and beauty in it. And he introduces alongside that the idea of a drone and the theme itself has got a sort of folksy element to it, and you have a drone underneath that from the orchestra. It gives the whole thing the impression of being related to folk music. And interestingly, dances, folk songs, he in the years immediately prior to writing the symphony had written a lot of arrangements of Scottish folk songs, Irish folk songs, as a way of making money.
Okay.
Because as I think we discussed last time, we have this impression of Beethoven in our heads as this sort of guy who wrote for posterity and you know, only the best, if you will.
Right.
And of course all his craftsmanship was great, but he did have to make ends meet, and so he'd been spending a lot of time thinking about these Celtic and melodies and writing arrangements, and it started to infuse this symphony. It's in there.
That's interesting.
It's clearly to be seen and to be heard. And you know, while talking about that figure, bum 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 bum, when we're working on it, he is so detailed about whether he puts dots or lines or rests.
Yes.
So the first iteration, he writes that figure without any dots, without any rests. So pa 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 pa, if you will. Then what he sometimes does is he'll write a rest after the first note. So pum pa pum pum pa pum pum pa pum pum or pum pa pa pum pa pa pum pa pa pum. And then sometimes he writes dots, dum da dum dum da dum dum da dum dum. And they're obviously very subtle differences, but it's an enormous challenge for all of us performing to be completely consistent, because he actually is. He's very clear. I want this. I want this. I want this.
Yeah.
And that's one of the first of many, you know, small performance issues that are potential pitfalls that, you know, for someone just listening and enjoying, you wouldn't necessarily be bothered. You wouldn't say, my God, the second clarinet just played the articulation more. but for us, you know, because we love, you know, we live for detail, right. All of us. It's a wonderfully interesting and exciting challenge to get right.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, then this second movement, which is one of the most sort of, it's just immediately moving of his movements. It's so romantic, and I think it is. I think, you know, you could say it's one of his most romantic movements.
Absolutely.
In the sense of expression.
Yeah.
That moves through into another scherzo, which is also, you know, rhythmic and bitey and has another drone section in the middle of it, a lot of sort of frenetic changes in dynamic, which are typical for his scherzo. And then the fourth movement starts almost as if in the middle of things. Rum da rum, bum ba da bum, rum da ga da ga da ga dum da ga da ga da ga dum da ga da ga da ga da la dee dum da ga da ga, and so on and so forth. And actually, that is also very similar to a folk tune that he had recently arranged.
Okay. So it's one of his more energetic.
It's extraordinary. The movement just goes and goes and goes.
Workout. Yeah.
It is a workout.
Totally
workout. Yeah. Discussing these six symphonies with an eye to our cycle that's coming up.
Mm-hmm.
Even though the Beethoven symphonies are at the core of everything you do as an orchestral musician, mm-hmm. They never cease to be a workout. And mm-hmm. for our orchestra, we, as you very well know, we have first oboe, second oboe, first clarinet, second. We don't have a lot of extra musicians in the woodwinds who can double up parts.
Yeah, so double winds.
Exactly. Yeah. So that it's. I think it's easier for our audience to not realize quite what that means. It means that Where in some orchestras you might get a symphony off you to practice the one that's coming up next, and someone else will come in for you. Particularly for our wind and brass players, but really for everybody in the orchestra, there's not a minute of you know,
let
up.
Everyone plays everything.
Yeah. And even when they're spread out over a few days, this is a, you know, it's an enormous challenge. These, not just the sort of stamina of getting through the pieces with the energy that it requires of you, because he's the fascinating thing about Beethoven's tempos, and again we touched on this last time, but is that they reflect actually these extreme, when people describe him and his playing and his improvisation and his personality, the tempi, which are in some, particularly in the Eighth Symphony, which we're about to talk about, they're almost nuts. They're frenetic and wild.
Yeah.
But they do reflect everything you read about him. And what with his dynamics when he writes fortissimo and then says pianissimo straight afterwards, it's like he's demanding of us as the performers to give everything.
Yeah.
And saying to us, I don't care if it feels uncomfortable. I don't care if you think this is impossible. Mm-hmm. Like he said of his pianos, I want them louder. I want them stronger. I want more singing. I want more. You know, he was a man of, in his art, on the one hand, extraordinary craft and discipline and calm and focus, but he demanded then of the listener, of the performer, these utter extremes, which I guess are reflective of, you know, life.
But also this increasing trend towards bigger, louder. The audience was changing, as we discussed last time. The audience was more for the mass.
Exactly.
And well, it's got to be exciting.
It's got to be exciting. And people seem to, you know, they seem to respond. I think we'll talk about it as we go through into the eighth and ninth, and you know, later into his life, especially towards the ninth. He's a fascinating example of a man who was, he was, you know, known all over Europe as the sort of greatest, as the greatest living musician, composer, and yet there was. He felt continually like the Viennese didn't really respect him and like him. I mean, he came from Bonn. Vienna to this day can be quite a sort of snobby, maybe is the word, you know, place. And I think he never felt he was given the respect that he deserved. And what I'm saying is, it's interesting that a man of that, who must have been aware of what he had achieved in music, and also knew, my name is famous around the world, I'm the most respected composer, still had a little chip on his shoulder. When it came to the ninth, as we will discuss, he it was to such a degree that he said, I don't want it to be premiered in Vienna. They don't deserve this. I wanted to go to Berlin. And his friends, who were wonderful, enlightened people, they had to write a petition that people would sign that was sent to him to kind of stroke his ego a little bit, to say to him, we do love you, please do it. So
it's interesting because many composers after him all struggled with writing symphonies because of his work.
Right.
They often talk about it in their memoirs, and they talk about the great symphony being nine. And that, what do we do next? And so it's interesting to, I didn't realize that he had this struggle with feeling appreciated.
And I think, you know, this is all actually going to lead into our discussion of the ninth, but he, it's easy when you think about a man like Beethoven, and I think any of the sort of great artists, scientists, politicians that we idolize, that what we see, you know, the nine symphonies and the quartets and the piano concertos, yes, they took a long time to write. But these people also, you know, Beethoven had to worry about his nephew.
He
couldn't find a woman who would marry him. And he, you know, he had the day-to-day issues of making money, looking after his family, that also will have undermined his confidence. I think if you're just writing great music and everyone's saying, oh, you're a god, it's one thing. But if women are not, you know, if he's not finding love the way you want, that's of course playing on you. And
and also the struggles with his family, as you mentioned.
And the fight he had. So his brother, in his will, said, "I want you to be the guardian of my son Carl," and that was a hugely divisive issue between Ludwig van Beethoven and his brother's wife, who was still alive, who of course said, "I want to keep control of my son," and there were lawsuits So the Fun in Beethoven is a Flemish name originally, but he in Germany at the time, and to this day, but at the time particularly, if you had fun in your name, it meant you were aristocratic. And at that time, that meant you would go to a different court, that you'd, everything, the whole legal system, everything was constructed differently. Okay. And it came out during the course of the proceedings to decide whether he should be guardian or not, that actually he wasn't high born, that the fun from the Flemish origin had nothing to do with, okay. with aristocracy. So, you know, all those sorts of things are happening and boiling away in the background. I think it's very interesting for us, and I think also for listeners in the audience to be aware not just of this genius on a pedestal, mm-hmm. but the fact that his music is a manifestation of the troubles that he had in his life that could have been any of our lives.
Right. And I'm sure we'll get into this more with the ninth, but the sense of the human spirit, the humanity of it.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
We'll do the eighth.
And yeah, let's get it going on the eighth then.
Let's just do a quick recap. So we've had the First and Second Symphonies, which were classical, rooted in classicism, where he immediately showed his own, you know, character. We go into the Third, Eroica, absolute mm-hmm. sort of defining work. It was a seismic effect on music. The Fourth is somewhat of a response to that. It's smaller in scale, but still, an extraordinary work.
I think we joked if there was any other composer, it would have been their finest work.
Exactly. But the Fourth, sandwiched between the Third and Fifth, which are these sort of defining symphonies. Mm-hmm. I happen to agree with you. I adore the Fourth. I adore all the symphonies. But there's a sort of cycle of the odd numbers, famously being mm-hmm. the sort of big definitive works, and the ones in between Four and Six, and now Eight, being mm-hmm. somewhat different. And they are perhaps more introverted. Mm-hmm. That's a blanket generalization is not really true at all, but the Sixth, the pastoral quality, the Fourth with the mysterious and beautiful introduction and the glorious slow movement, and now the Eighth is again a complete contrast to the Seventh. This apotheosis of dance, this extraordinary sort of compelling and fun piece, the Seventh, really. And the Eighth, he does something weird. It's like, in retrospect, he looks back one more time to his roots before he takes his next step, which is the Ninth. And why would I say that? Well, everything about the Eighth is related to classicism, and in one way or another a sort of parody of classicism. So he goes back to the key of F major. He sets a very, very quick tempo for the first movement. It's in 3-4, which he hadn't done for a first movement since the Eroica. And there are little... Well, let me put it a different way. When the Seventh and Eighth were performed together, so when the premiere of the Eighth occurred, the Seventh was repeated on the program. And there's this famous comment that was made that the Eighth wasn't as good as the Seventh, and or that it wasn't appreciated by the audience as much as the Seventh. And Beethoven said, that's because it's much better. I think he was just a little upset. Yeah, but actually there's this sort of, if you will, for want of a better way of putting it, for sort of the connoisseurs of the time, there's lovely, lovely little things that he does in it that are a parody. And so, for example, the opening is in F major, and then he ends up modulating the wrong direction into this second subject. Mm-hmm. And what you'll hear there is na 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 ni na 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 ni na 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 ni na ni na na ni, and he modulates there into the correct key. Right. Now, for someone, this may sound a little lame, but someone listening at the time who was sort of who was really rooted in the expectations of the classical structure of a symphony, it would have been a wonderful joke. He went to the wrong key and then modulated into the right key, and we end up with C sharps, D flats in the second subject, which shouldn't be there. He's just gone the wrong direction. And in the second movement, again, it's enormously classical. It's
very classical.
Yeah, and he quotes notionally the clock symphony, Haydn.
Yes, yeah.
There's also been stories over the years that it was to do with the metronome, but I think it's more explicitly to do with the clock symphony. And it's very beautifully kind of perfumed music and phrased. Mm-hmm. It could be a, you know, Haydn or Mozart movement. And then for the first time in his symphonies, he goes back, like in the first one, to the idea of a real minuet and trio.
The trio is really classical.
Yeah, yeah. He says, I'm going to do it. And it's called a minuet. And and he does that. And in the last movement, which is incredibly fast, in the tempo that he asks for, he just brings back this one idea that we'd had in the first movement of this errant C sharp that led us to the wrong modulation, and he has the basses and a couple of points play it it's just this weird it's this weird for him logic that he had to sort of bring that back to play with the idea again. But ultimately, you know, it's very short. It's shorter than the previous six symphonies. Only the first is shorter. It goes by in a flash, but it's beautifully crafted.
It's one of my favorites.
Yeah, I know.
I love that symphony.
It's so elegant. It's so light. It's so clever. It's so witty. And it is a wonderful sort of palate freshener, if you will, before we go into the ninth. So we've arrived. So,
right.
Yeah.
The world doesn't change forever.
Yeah. And this is, you know, the ninth is a very difficult piece to, it's just, it is extraordinary what he did in this one piece. I mean, just the scale of it for a start is like nothing he'd done before.
It's even the rule book. It's completely gone.
Exactly. Yeah. Even in the Eroica. But when we're discussing, I think it's useful to start with the end, because as Beethoven often did, he sort of had a teleological way of composing. He said, right, I want to get here, how do I get there? And since he was a young man, so the Ode to Joy was written in 1785 by Schiller as a poem, and from a young age Beethoven was fascinated by that poem, and it was, you know, written during the height of the Enlightenment. It engendered ideas, morals, sort of ethics that Beethoven believed in from a young age that he carried with them. And the world has, in the meantime, changed. So we had the French Revolution. Mm-hmm. We had Napoleon. We had the height of Napoleon's power. He names himself emperor. Beethoven's furious. Mm-hmm. He goes on to invade Russia. His army falls. He's defeated at Wellington. He goes to Elba. He's defeated again. And he gets sent to, you know, the St. Helens. And what we have in Europe now is a return to aristocracy rule. Mm-hmm. And the sort of counter-revolution.
Right.
And the Vienna that he's writing in when we get to the Ninth Symphony is one that is sensorial and much more restrictive. Mm. And he and his he had an enlightened and progressive circle of friends. They're being very careful about what they say and what they do. Mm. And mm-hmm. those freedoms that had been won for a brief time during Napoleon's time at rule have been lost again. Mm-hmm. So he, in a way, it was a slightly strange choice that he would take this old poem that really stood for another age. But at the same time, it was probably the moment to do it, to pick it. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting to ask ourselves, well, I tell you what, first of all, I brought, for our listeners, I just brought a translation into English because many of you will have been used to hearing it in the German, and will have a sort of feel for what it means and may even understand the German. But I'll just read the lines that are from Schiller and then talk about the stuff that comes from Beethoven. So here's the poem that he quotes in the symphony. Joy, beautiful spark of divinity, daughter of Elysium, we enter burning with fervor, heavenly being, your sanctuary. Your magic brings together what custom has sternly divided. All men shall become brothers wherever your gentle wings hover. Whoever has been lucky enough to become a friend to a friend, whoever has found a beloved wife, let him join our songs of praise. Yes, and anyone who can call one soul his own on this earth. Any who cannot, let them slink away from this gathering in tears. Every creature drinks in joy at nature's breast. Good and evil alike follow her trail of roses. She gives us kisses and wine, a true friend even in death. Even the worm was given desire, and the cherub stands before God. Gladly, just as his sons hurtle through the glorious universe, so you brothers should run your course joyfully like a conquering hero. Be embraced, you millions. This kiss is for the whole world. Brothers, above the canopy of stars must dwell a loving father. Do you bow before him, you millions? Do you sense your creator, O world? Seek him above the canopy of stars. He must dwell beyond the stars. Mm. So those are the stanzas that he took from the poem. Mm-hmm. For those of you out there who know a bit about the poem and just want to be clear about it, there's two versions. There's 1785, and then Schiller updated it a little bit in 1808, and that's the version that Beethoven used. Mm-hmm. And I think just before we talk about the music, it's interesting to pick out a few words. So the word brother comes up a lot. That's mm-hmm. a sort of typical Enlightenment, Illuminati, Masonic mm-hmm. word. And this idea of joy, I mean, we'll talk also about the idea of who this creator is above mm-hmm. the stars. I think his relationship to religion was an interesting one. I think in everything that he, that you sort of see him writing or thinking about religion, he was not a Christian in the sense that a lot of other people would have been mm-hmm. around his time. He was interested in God, but the direct connection with God rather than through Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. He also apparently in the years prior to this was reading about Eastern philosophy. He was interested in other iterations of what that is above the cloudy, mm-hmm. you know, above the starry sky, this something, your creator, your God. Mm-hmm. I think a starting point when thinking about his relationship there to God, because he starts off with man and then he goes into this idea of God above mm-hmm. the starry sky, is to remember that perhaps he's talking about a more universal God than just this Christian iteration. Yeah. In fact, I'm certain of it.
Okay.
But ultimately, it's about this brotherhood and about joy. Now, why joy? Why not love or freedom? Mm-hmm. And it's been postulated that the original version of Ode to Joy, oder an der Freude was, oder an der Freiheit, so the freedom, mm-hmm. Rather than joy. But joy, I read an interesting argument about this by Jan Swafford, who's going to be joining us during the festival mm-hmm. to tour, the very, very brilliant writer on Beethoven and many other composers. But he points out that for the enlightened soul, joy is the end, and a way to it is through love, mm. is through freedom, is through truth, is through honesty, is through mm-hmm. through roots. Mm-hmm. But this ultimate sense of joy between all of us mm-hmm. can be achieved in different ways.
Yeah, yeah.
And for a man who hadn't been fulfilled by love, he just hadn't found it in his life, maybe this idea of joy as the unifying force mm-hmm. seemed very honest. Anyway,
yeah, no, you know,
it's a very interesting question to get into, and there's brilliant writing. As I mentioned, Jan Swafford has written wonderful things about it, but many other great writers, there's a lot of literature out there. Either way, this poem has been in his life for the whole of his life. Mm-hmm. And the first thing he wanted to do was find his tune, find his melody. Mm-hmm. And I don't think I could think of an example in the history of music where somebody who set out to write an anthem for the world mm-hmm. literally said to themselves, I want to write an anthem for the people, yeah. that they could have been more successful. This is the national anthem of the European Union. It is mm-hmm. It's famed across the world, and it stands across the world mm-hmm. for humanity. Mm-hmm. At least half of humanity know this tune.
Yeah,
hundreds of years later.
Yeah,
and the process of refining it down to the theme that we know and love was long mm-hmm. and arduous for him. He was so self-critical. He really needed to weed it down to the simplest and most concise form, and he did that. Mm-hmm. And then he worked backwards. And I mean, there were some sketches from years earlier of the introduction in D minor, which he did use. Mm-hmm. But then he constructed the other movements with that arrival point of mm-hmm. in mind. And just to excuse me, quickly outline the first few movements, because I'd love to talk in detail about the fourth movement. We start in a manner in which he hasn't actually started a symphony before. In fact, I really don't think anyone has started a symphony like this. Haydn, in his oratorio creation and things, he'd gone for this. But mm-hmm.
there's a very mysterious quality.
Yeah, you have firstly, the cellian basses are on an A and an E in a mm-hmm. symphony in D minor. So there's already, it takes a couple of pages of the score before we hear D minor. Mm-hmm. But we're in this sort of primordial space.
Oh, that's a good way to describe it.
And you hear... and this is something he comes back to in the last moment. You hear the music being composed, if you mm-hmm. will. You hear the fifth, then you try out a fifth. Ba-bom, ba-bom. Mm. Ba-bom, ba-bim, ba-bom. Then he develops that theme. Ba-bi-lum, bi-bi-lum, ba-bi-lum. Ba-bi-ya-ba-ya-ba-ya-bum. And then finally he cadences for the first time into D minor. And it's really, I think, an attitude in the music, an emotion that... we haven't met in his symphonies yet. Yeah. It's actually almost angry. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sorry, I hit the table.
That
there.
Was impressive, though.
Excitement. Yeah.
Reverberating in here.
but yeah, it's a color that we haven't in the symphonies really seen like that. Mm-hmm. And interestingly, just a few bars later, he introduces. It will be unbeknownst to the first listeners. Mm-hmm. He introduces the theme, which we will hear in the last movement. It's like, what's that called when you plant words in people's head? There's a linguistic technique. Oh, I can't remember what it's called. I'm sure our listeners will know. But there's a linguistic technique where without saying the thing you want people to say, you plant it in their minds. And this is what he's doing here. He just... starts to allude very subtly to the theme we're all going to hear mm-hmm. 45 minutes later in the last movement.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, that first movement remains driven. It remains angry. It's succinct.
It ends that way too.
It does. And it is the first time also, just as an aside, for those of you who are interested in the sort of structural stuff, he doesn't repeat the exposition. So normally right. in a symphony, the first bit of the first movement will be repeated. He doesn't do that. He just powers through. Mm-hmm. And yeah, the end is extraordinary because we just spoke earlier about the funeral march in the mm-hmm. third, the seventh. Mm-hmm. This is his final funeral march in the symphony. The coda of the first movement goes into this pained funeral march.
Yes.
And ends pretty abruptly then. And, you know, for those of us looking for an arc, this could be an allusion to those things that he dealt with earlier in his life, like Napoleon mm-hmm. and so on and so forth. But frankly, it's just extraordinary music. Then we go into a scherzo. We didn't actually talk about, yeah, but the timpani is an interesting, the scherzo is tuned in yes. octaves. And yeah. this was fun for people at the time. We have bum 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 bum. So the timpani play in octaves, which was very unusual. He'd done it once before mm-hmm. in his symphonies, but it was very unusual for the time and is still an unusual color. And we're back to this scherzo, having moved back into the minuet in the Eighth Symphony. But again, the scherzo is driven. It's highly contrapuntal. It's probably the most contrapuntal of any of his scherzos.
Complex,
yeah,
so
fugues are in yeah. there, and there is also in the trio section mm-hmm. again a reference to the theme that'll come in the last movement. So again, he's planting the ti-ra-ra-dim in our minds. Mm-hmm. We go into a slow movement, which is a double set of variations, mm-hmm. which is something that sort of Haydn would do. So you have a theme one, theme two, and then they come back and they have variations on them. But the scale again is very large for
it's
the period.
It's a long movement.
It's a tricky really? Movement for all of us when we're performing it
yeah.
to make sure that we sort of get the arc right.
Yeah.
I always find it before I started, I'm thinking, right, just, you know, have in mind these long limbs, because actually mm-hmm. the differentiation between the themes is not so great. You know, there's not a huge contrast.
I agree.
Yeah, it's a really tricky one.
But it's color that he does it a lot.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And the color is very, very unique.
Okay, and so I'm sorry, we've been fairly quick in our discussion of one first, second, and third movement, but I think it's useful to get into the fourth and talk about it a little in detail for our listeners, because even, you know, from the time it was first performed, apparently for you know, decades and even into the 20th century, it was a bit of a conundrum for people. What the hell's going on?
Well, we should also like highlight why it's not a traditional symphony in terms of the orchestration. Like, we actually have choir on stage for those who aren't familiar with the piece.
Precisely. Okay.
So, soloist singers, which is not what a traditional symphony was.
Precisely. So. And I think that's that's a very good way to set up the last movement, because up until now, it's just been an orchestral symphony. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, it's been big boned and it's been dramatic and there've been new ideas, but ultimately it's along the lines of what people would have expected. But there's a chorus sitting on stage.
Yeah.
And now there are soloists, and people are probably thinking, well, what's going on here? Why? Mm-hmm. And it's, of course, because he wants to introduce this poem, the Ode to Joy. He's decided for the first time in the history of symphonic music to introduce choir and solo voices. Mm-hmm. But he has then a challenge when he starts the fourth movement. How do I prepare this? It's never been done. How do I introduce voices in a symphony? Yeah. And his solution is such an interesting one. So it starts off with what Wagner again called the terror chord, mm-hmm. which is a distance. It's actually it's D minor with a B flat in it.
Okay, yeah.
And it sounds almost bitonal. That's like somebody sort of proverbially scratching across the page and saying, let's start something new. Mm. Okay, what's going to happen
now? Actually, this is the coolest moment. I know. Piece, what happens next?
And then you hear a recitative, what sounds to the world like a recitative, but without any text, mm-hmm. and without a singer. It's the double basses and the cellos who go mm-hmm. mm-hmm. and then again you hear the terror chord. This was unheard of. Mm-hmm. The idea that the cellos and the basses would play some kind of recitative. It's marked in the style of a recitative, but a tempo.
Yes.
That's what he marks, which mm-hmm. is a kind of almost a contradiction in terms, and it's a very interesting challenge to try and realize that. Mm-hmm. And what proceeds to happen then for our listeners is you have that terror chord, comes twice. Mm-hmm. And then a longer recitative passage starts. And what you'll hear is a section of recitative from the cellos and the basses, then a quote from the first movement, mm-hmm. then a section of recitative, then a quote from the second movement, then a section of recitative, then a quote from the third movement. And I'm just going to talk about that before I continue. When he composed this, he wrote in his notes, in his sketches, a text above these cello bass recitative lines. And in essence, what these texts say are, we need to find the right melody now for us mm-hmm. to proceed. Mm-hmm. Then he quotes the first movement and he says, that's not the right one. That's a little bit too sad for what we're looking mm-hmm. for. Then he quotes the second movement. And then in the recitative, he says, no, that's just sport. That's not what we're looking for. Then he quotes the third movement. He said, that's very beautiful, but we need something more animated. So in his mind's eye, Beethoven is literally with this recitative searching mm-hmm. for his idea. And of course, he well knows he's got it. But he decided to get rid of the text,
yeah.
but he did have it in mind. We know that, this precise text.
Well, it's kind of interesting that this entire section, it's quite actually fairly long. It's an introduction.
Yeah.
And it could be a work that's standalone in a way if you wanted to take the rest of the symphony away. But what I find interesting is you mentioned that previous movements quote what is going to happen in the Ode to Joy. But and here,
we're backwards.
It's poetic that he would, while searching around for where he's going to land, quote everything else he's already said in that symphony with this recitative that you mentioned.
Absolutely. It's beautiful. And it's amazing. Then after the, having quoted the third movement, he says, that's not animated enough. Mm. And then there's a little cadence in the woodwinds. And then the next bit of recitative, which goes bom bim bo bo bi dom. He wrote in German, ja dies, dieses ist es. So yes, this is it. This is the one we're looking for. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to take that and run with it. Cadence, bom, bom. And then what we hear, I talked about, so the whole introduction of the fourth movement is this idea of let's find the theme, let's find this joy that I'm looking for. And then we get there. And this seminal moment of history, in music, I find it difficult to conduct it without the hairs on my arm standing up. Yeah. Because this lifetime's journey for him to express that poem.
Yeah.
As a sort of an expression of who he is, what he believes in. He was a very moral man. Mm-hmm. It's an extraordinary moment because he could have, after flum, bam, this big cadence, he could have gone, he could have gone fortissimo.
So polite and so sincere.
And this exactly, it's so honest. So sincere, it's a beautiful word. And what you see here, in a very different way to the first movement, where he composes anger and darkness before our eyes, is you take the most beautifully crafted theme and it's expressed just by the cellos and basses. Then he adds, for me, again, I always get a tear in my eye when I hear the bassoon counterpoint start. Yeah. It is so beautiful.
It's a great counterpoint.
Oh, it's extraordinary. It's amazing. And he just builds in front of our eyes the counterpoint and the joy. You hear a layer of joy being added onto this.
Absolutely.
Really, and then it explodes into this this orchestral fortissimo statement of Freude. There's no words yet. So we hear it. He shows his hand. He shows this is where we're going to go. And then we hear the terror chord again. And this time, a singer stands up.
It's kind of a heralding moment.
Exactly.
This, announcing this next change.
Exactly.
New idea.
And this time, and I'll get the English text for everybody. The first words that are spoken, and this again is so fascinating. You think that no one had ever sung in a symphony. Beethoven wrote the words, the first words that we hear. And he says, oh, friends, not these sounds. Oh, Freunde, nicht diese Töne. So not these notes, not these sounds. Sondern lasst uns angenehmer anstimmen. So let us instead strike up more pleasing and joyful tones. And then he says, Freude, joy. Freude, joy. And then the chorus, they all sing joy.
Yeah.
And everyone sings joy. And then we hear, and this is, again, fascinating about the poem. So the Schiller poem is not... it's not meant to be read, as some kind of deeply sort of affecting, intimate, personal thing. It's a drinking song. It's in the style of the geselliges Lied. It was of the period. It was these songs that the brothers would sing in a tavern with a big, hopefully, glass of beer.
Yeah.
Joy, beautiful spark of divinity, daughter of Elysium. It's got that sense to it. And you have the chorus literally shouting Freude, Freude, joy, joy, joy all over the place, and you hear a march when they're saying let's be like a hero, and
there's a boisterous quality to it.
You go into a Turkish march.
The
influence of the East again, the idea that maybe the East and the West aren't so far apart. And
I just have to say one more time for those who are listening, the fact that there's this many ideas and different things being thrown into a symphony. It threw composer's concept of what a symphony was on its head.
Absolutely.
This is why they were struggled for so much after Beethoven wrote this.
He
did it all. What can we do?
It's absolutely extraordinary.
It's unbelievable.
And the other thing to sort of note as we pass it is that it had been an increasing trend for Beethoven to make the symphony back heavy, so to speak, so that the last movement was becoming more and more important. And this is the sort of final iteration of that, that the fourth movement of the Ninth Symphony could be, as you said, a piece, a standalone piece. It's so big. And you really only start to see that again with Mahler. Who, you know, it's a very direct relationship. The Second Symphony, chorus, soloist.
Completely influenced by Beethoven.
And it happens to also be one of the greatest pieces ever written. You know, we could talk about that for a long time too. But yeah, he then goes into this poem, and we have the soloists with the chorus, sometimes soloists alone, sometimes. He introduces the Turkish march music. For me, there's a section which I find deeply sort of affecting and is the soul, if you will, for me, of this last movement, which is the passage where he says, "Be embraced, you millions, this kiss is for the whole world. Brothers above the canopy of stars must dwell a loving father." And it's because of the way that Beethoven sets it. The German words that you'll hear are Seid umschlungen, Millionen, be embraced, you millions. Diesen Kuss der ganzen Welt, this kiss for the whole world. And then he said, Brüder überm Sternenzelt, so above the canopy of stars, must ein lieber Vater wohnen, there must live, must dwell a loving father. Now, listen out for the word muss, so must, because in the choral setting that he decides to write, they emphasize must, this desperate, you can hear almost on his part this desperation. I want to believe that there's something up there. There must be something. And when he says, when in a stanza before that, the cherub stands before God, it's one of the most striking moments in the symphony. Cherub steht vor Gott. A big chord.
Huge moment.
And it's actually then that he decides to go into this weirdly boom, 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 this Turkish march. So this section around there I find fascinating, but that's the one I find most affecting, when you can hear his, if you will, personal desperation. That's how I feel it always coming through. There must be something up there. I don't know what it is, but there must be something that is, you know.
Do you know what the text is, that the moment the singers are by themselves as a quartet?
That's, I can tell you.
I'm just curious.
The first one, or so
that's
the,
another moment I find to be incredibly powerful.
Oh yeah, the one at the very end, the last. Yeah. So the what he's done there is he's gone back to the beginning, and all people will be brothers, where your gentle wings, what's the actual proper translation? Hold on. All men shall become brothers wherever your gentle wings hover.
Okay.
That's what they're seeing. So they've gone back to the beginning. Okay. And from the very first performance, the singer said to him, "You're a bastard for writing this."
That's a really hard moment, that quartet.
It is incredibly difficult.
The
back then and to this day, it is one of the least thankful things for. It really is.
For because, singers, yeah.
Yeah, it's hideous. It's absolutely so horrible. It is so beautiful, but the register is so hard for all of them. And he demands of them, you know, they sing long and sustained and legato and in a register that isn't comfortable. So it is very hard, but. It is. The Ninth Symphony, I know, divides some people. I have close friends who are great musicians, and they can't quite get on board with the Ninth. They prefer the Fifth or the Third. For me, it's the arrival point. I love all the others. I think they're incredible, but the Ninth would be one of my desert island. You know,
I would agree with you.
Yeah,
yeah.
And I think it's partly because of that variety. Because of the depth and the breadth of expression, and also even to this day, particularly, and I'm glad we got to talk about it, when you think of it from this point of view, the extraordinary freshness of invention, and
it's experimental for its time.
Yeah,
completely.
Yeah. And harmonically speaking, still there's we could in a rehearsal have fun doing it, but when you have the repeat of the terror chord that introduces the singer, he builds, let me see if I can find the chord for you. He builds he adds not just the B flat on top of it, but he builds a truly kind of a bitonal chord. Yeah, it would be, if any of you who happen to sort of download or have a score on hand, look at, just add up all the number of different notes that he uses in measure 208. It'd just be a little fun bit of homework for you, but it's quite an extraordinary chord, and way ahead of its time. If you got an orchestra to just hold that chord nowadays, you'd think that it was written in the last week.
But it's earth shattering.
Yeah, it is.
It's amazing. It's perfect. It's the perfect way to herald the beginning of that movement and all the ideas that are going to come afterwards. The interruptive quality of it. It's so good.
Amazing.
Thanks again, Maestro, for taking the time to do this.
Thank you.